Hello everyone, Zarek Zahakron here with another talk video. I know it's been some time since I've covered Elder Scrolls lore as a concept, the last one being one of my nitpick land videos where I kind of made fun of the whole CODA concept. Now, if you're unfamiliar with what CODA is, we'll get into that a little bit later. So today, I'm going to discuss Elder Scrolls lore as a concept and how it ties together with Bethesda's history, both as a company and as a franchise. Now I'm going to go over the franchise history first, and then I'll slowly break into what kind of implications that has for the lore of the games. And then most importantly, explaining how the lore community itself has changed from the beginning to the end. Most people who frequent this channel are familiar with my Elder Scrolls lore series. If you aren't, I recommend pausing the video and having a gander at the playlist I have in the video description. I will be continuing that series at some point soon. I recommend Googling WoW Wiki soon for a more exact definition on that. So let's go back to the very, very beginning of the franchise. The game studio Bethesda created an arena fighting game that was relabeled Elder Scrolls Arena, when they decided that the side quests were more fun than the arena fighting game itself. They threw out the entire arena concept, and then drawing on their Dungeons & Dragons and Tolkien experience, they created their own fantasy land, Tamriel. Other than some pretty basic stuff, Arena was, for all intents and purposes, generic fantasy. What Arena did give us, however, was all the primary towns and locations in all the provinces. We got a feeling for the general atmosphere of each province from the world map, and the various dungeons we got to delve into established what to expect from each province, from Labyrinthian in Skyrim to the dungeons of Dagoth in Morrowind to the halls of Colossus to Mirkwood, so on. Arena established it all. But other than the whole dynasty of Uriel Septim and the perfidy of Jaeger Tharn, there really wasn't much to the story. It was very, very basic. The lore itself didn't get started until the next game in the franchise, Elder Scrolls II: Daggerfall. This is when they started introducing books in-game that you could read. Various beta testers got named as gods. So, for example, one of the beta testers named Smaug from The Hobbit became also known as the Old Smaug himself, a.k.a. T-O-S-H, Akatosh. Many of the other gods were similarly named. The foundations of much of the lore books we read today were written by forum users who wanted to contribute to the world Bethesda was creating. So much of the lore was actually community-sourced. This is a very important fact, and we'll get back to that later. It has an impact on this overall video. Now, in Daggerfall, the Daedra were invented as gameplay mechanics and referred to by some as demons. They actually took possession of children. You had to do exorcisms to get Daedric spirits out of them. Daedric princes were referred to by the narrator as the gods in Oblivion. Each Daedra had a summoning day, something even Skyrim would reference later. You could summon a Daedric prince and do a quest for them. Daedric relics were the rewards, and it was established that Daedric relics had a will of their own and would abandon their user eventually. The first pocket guide to the Empire gave us an amazing view of the provinces we will never see again. Did you know that Cyrodiil was supposed to have rust dragons? Hell, dragons were referenced in all the early Elder Scrolls games. Anyway, Daggerfall also had a side plot regarding the Princess of Wayrest making a deal with the King of Worms. This plot was supposed to tie into either an expansion pack or a sequel to Daggerfall, but it never did. In some of the books, there were even references to the Aldmeri Dominion back then. In short, Daggerfall had community-driven lore that developed something unique, something separate from other fantasy worlds. Tamriel was developing into its own fantasy world as a result, with its own set of rules. It was becoming something that wasn't just a Dungeons & Dragons ripoff that we saw in Arena. And it wasn't just a homage to real-life events, although that would change later, and I'll explain why. But before we get into that, let's go over the other games. Battlespire was originally going to be an expansion pack for Daggerfall, but it was reworked into its own game that took place between Elder Scrolls 1 and 2. It featured the most sarcastic protagonist ever created. And it was also the first time you faced off against Mehrunes Dagon. Although he was featured in Daggerfall, he wasn't actually an enemy. He was someone you could do a quest for. Anyway, during this time, right after Battlespire, Bethesda created Elder Scrolls Adventures Redguard, which I hold up to this day to be the best storytelling Bethesda has ever done.
What is it? Did it work?
I'm sorry, Cyrus.
What's wrong? What happened? What did you do wrong?
It didn't work.
What now, Redguard?
The sword. His soul is in the sword.
She doesn't know. It was...
Who cares how it happened? It's over, Cyrus. We can't follow a sword. You failed us. We are through.
Cautious, I've thought you, Basil, but never before a coward. We all have waited for the prince's return. Now that he has returned, you walk away. The form is different, true, but his spirit is here, here. And isn't his spirit the truest part of him? Did it occur that maybe he chose this shape and symbol as the sign of his intentions? Aye, perhaps that soul in hated delay snared helpless in a jewel while his men hid and shirked their duties. His duty! Perhaps that soul honed itself to this and by no mistake comes to you now in no more fine and final form as this. A sword. You say you cannot follow a sword? Well, I say that you have strayed from your own too long. Why are you here but to fight? Your prince has shown you the manner of his purest metal, aye, and metal itself. And this true, unerring razor's message is clear beyond words, for now's not the time for words, but for brave hands, bright swords, and blood. Aye, boys, it's about blood now, too long frozen in your veins. And you'd rather yourself be rigid than follow me. Well, if you won't, then shamefully know that your prince will. For his blood be solid too, but straightened to steel and tempered in death. Arise alike as he, as swords as we are crowned alike as he. The prince is dead. Long live the prince!
And the worst game in the Elder Scrolls series. It's a game that was designed for specialized hardware, and it's so janky, it's nearly impossible to get it running as it was originally intended on modern hardware. Oh, you can run it, but it'll run somewhere between suboptimally and horribly. Now, even for back then, the controls were just atrocious, the timing felt off, and the combat was just very janky. According to reports, Elder Scrolls Adventures Redguard was the first game in the franchise to have a rather notorious writer named Michael Kirkbride work on it. How much of an influence he had on the game is debatable. However, he did work on it with Todd Howard. Now, it was during this time that on the old Bethesda forums, not the ones up today, there was a growing community. And in that community, fan fiction ran wild. Everyone wanted to see the next thing in the Elder Scrolls, keeping in mind that although the community was growing, it was mostly due to a dedicated few. And in reality, Battlespire and Redguard could be thought of as commercial failures. It was during this time that Bethesda ran into financial trouble while working on a sci-fi game called 10th Planet. Combined with the commercial failures of Battlespire and Redguard, even with their small, dedicated community, they nearly went bankrupt. 10th Planet was cancelled, and Bethesda was acquired by ZeniMax Media, which saved their company from bankruptcy. With a fresh cash infusion, there was a fire lit under the developers' asses. They consolidated the teams into a single team, containing many of their best minds from those other teams. to work on a main-titled Elder Scrolls game, Morrowind. Although Todd Howard would later refer to this as a new lease on life, and the members of the development team were to think of this as joining the ZeniMax family, reports running contrary to that actually talk about an air of desperation to make this the best game they possibly could because it might very well be their last. They had to make it from a fresh angle and separate from all the previous entries until then, and most importantly, they had to make sure that it didn't get confused with generic fantasy at all. It had to set itself apart or this wasn't going to work. It had to stand above all the other games that were coming out. And that's why they decided to make Morrowind this truly alien-looking place. Home of Daedra worshippers and wild creatures you'd never see in normal fantasy. In short, they wanted to create something new. They felt like they had to create something new, or so I've been told. Now, according to those I've spoken to, I have to stress this part. None of this is officially published. None of it can be outright proven. So this is word of mouth only. But according to my sources, much of the problems in the series began there, with Ken Rolston. Acting as lead designer, he had a style that very much clashed with some of the other developers who worked under him. Ken had a rather large rule that he insisted on for the entire story, and that was everything must be a metaphor, or everything must be based on something else. Basically, what that meant is, unless you could attach your idea to a pre-existing concept in the real world, that idea wasn't valid and would not be used. The reason it was that way is follows. Using real life as a grounding tool makes the world feel more believable. When you make up things on your own, you're more likely to break the suspension of disbelief. This explanation was not only confirmed by one of my sources, but this explanation is confirmed in an interview that I will touch on a little later on. Anyway, remember that alien Cyrodiil I talked about in the lore that had rust dragons and all these fantastical things? This kind of fantasy world empire? Now, under Ken's guidance, where everything must be a metaphor, what is the first thing you think of when you think of an empire? Roman Empire, right? Bank. The Imperials are now representative of Romans. A unique fantasy world taken away. Now grounded in the mundane. Now you can see how resentment reportedly built up in the design team at this time. People who worked on Daggerfall, or people who looked at Daggerfall for inspiration originally. People who worked with the community. A whole fantasy world of ideas being built up, only to have the lead designer say, nope, it's not representative of a real life event, and shut it all down. Countless amount of community ideas and feedback ended up in the dumpster. And the Elder Scrolls world, as it was depicted in the first edition of the Pocket Guide to the Empire, was entirely rewritten. Many people in the Elder Scrolls lore community attribute this to the Dragon Break or the Warp in the West, which is used to explain how all of Daggerfall's endings were canon. But in reality, this was simply the result of lead designer Ken's game direction disagreeing with the previous installments in The Elder Scrolls. Now, reports I hear say there was a dissonance between various members of the design team. Some of the quest designers who'd worked on the Fighters Guild and the Mages Guild and so on wanted to give the player as many choices as possible and never put words in the player's mouth. They wanted to develop characters first, then build a story around them. However, they say that Ken's style was very much to look at everything from a top-down perspective and design the narrative first, filling in the characters as nodes for that particular story. An addendum was that Todd Howard just wanted the player to feel awesome and feel like they were actually getting something accomplished. One product, three different viewpoints on how to accomplish it, and countless in-between viewpoints from other members of the staff. Morrowind, the third game in the franchise, was to take place in all of the province of Morrowind, but when adjusting to the brand new Gamebryo engine, variants of which Oblivion and yes, even Skyrim use, I'm talking about the creation engine. Well, back when they were first getting used to game bryo, it was determined without the massive amount of algorithmically generated content Daggerfall used, it simply wouldn't be feasible to do the entire province on the kind of scale they wanted. So they ended up placing the entire game on the island of Vardenfell. Although at the time, they hadn't got quite a feeling for how Dark Elf culture was going to be. In fact, as far as I hear it, a good chunk of the game development came through before they even figured that out. A lot of it was apparently the result of Michael Kirkbride's writings. His peers would call Michael Kirkbride a genius. To quote an interview, "An insane genius, but a genius nonetheless." From what I've heard, a lot of the Dark Elf culture came from Michael Kirkbride's writings, and the lead designer, looking at Michael Kirkbride's writings, decided that it would be non-committal. What that means is that Bethesda was going to have no stance on how true those writings were. Is Vivek lying to all his people? Is it all true? Is it half lies? Bethesda decided there and then to leave it up to the player to decide. While Arena and Daggerfall had solidified the type of game The Elder Scrolls was going to be, the choice the developers made during Morrowind to leave whether or not the lore was true up to the player, that's what really solidified The Elder Scrolls franchise into what it is today, as far as the lore goes. At that point, it was okay for the lore to contradict itself because they accepted the fact that these books are written by in-universe people and could often be wrong. And in fact, they promoted the idea that some of these books are wrong. And the innate contradictions actually created a more believable world. Now, in my personal opinion, that acts to both the game's benefit and detriment. It means that it's very difficult to say with authority, this happened, and create an indisputable timeline. Instead, you create a timeline you wish to create. After Morrowind came out, a couple former developers thought there was going to be this huge backlash regarding all the community feedback they've been getting. Everything they could have integrated that they wanted to integrate but never could. About the countless ideas that got turned into real-world symbolic things. But they were surprised when the backlash never came. People genuinely loved this world that Bethesda had created. Morrowind has quite a few less pen-and-paper RPG elements than Daggerfall had, but no one seemed to care about those either. By all reports, Bethesda had found a happy medium of mechanics and accessibility. However, a mere month later, when players of the Xbox version got their hands on the game, they would report the inability to properly hit enemies, aka the feeling of a broken combat system, and they felt that they were getting lost all the time. So quite a few people quit the Xbox version of it because this is all they had known and it wasn't a pleasant experience for them. The same mechanics that were praised in the PC release, a complex RPG system with a fresh open world to explore with no hand-holding, was solemnly rejected by most Xbox players. Regardless of that, Morrowind flourished on the PC, and it defined Elder Scrolls lore in the sense that, for the most part, the lore was overwritten. Nobody cared about the old concepts, and they latched onto the brand new ones introduced in Morrowind. A majority of the Elder Scrolls lore community was established at this time, and because of that ambiguity within the franchise, it caused speculative fan fiction to blossom. Now, a huge chunk of said lore community is actually offended if you use the word fan fiction, stating that you can't have fiction about a fictional universe. But indeed, canon does exist, and Bethesda defines what is canon. So when someone's fan theory contradicts what's in the canon, if there isn't direct evidence to support their claim, their fan theory is more or less taken as fan fiction. Which, don't get me wrong, there are fan fictions that easily surpass the source material. But trademark and copyrights are very clear. The Elder Scrolls, the entire universe, everything in it, belongs to Bethesda. If you want to create derivative works, that's absolutely fine. But those derivative works are fan fiction. Now, why did I mention all of this? Because there are some people who were writing for Daggerfall's community who never stopped. In fact, they were joined by people writing exclusively from Morrowind's lore. And very quickly, Morrowind became the base of fanfiction creations. Much of the Bethesda forums and on other websites, they became filled with such fanfiction. Fanfiction in the form of speculations and fan theories. Now, 99.9% of this out-of-game lore will never be used in any of the games. And a good chunk of it has been outright contradicted or proven invalid by later entries in the series. But remember, this is fan fiction we're talking about. These are stories and speculation by the fans, for the fans. By now, your average Skyrim fan, who isn't a member of the lore community, is rolling their eyes. Yeah, those belong on fanfiction.net, right? We shouldn't be taking that as canon, right? And for the most part, you are correct. The thing is that this entirely intentional ambiguity written within the Elder Scrolls lends credence to many of these fan theories, and it's actually become the source of all the speculation. That speculation then becomes accepted by the greater community as truth, even if it isn't really canon. A great example would be the Argonians, who, if you ask any lore community member, will tell you that the Hist warned them about the incoming Oblivion Crisis, and they stormed the gates and actually shut them on their own. In reality, according to the canon, the Argonians put up the best defense, and a few of them actually entered gates. No Hist warning, no storming, no shutting. Just, they entered a few gates, basically. But you can see how an article on Reddit about the Argonians became so talked about that it worked its way into a wiki, and Shoddy Cast read the wiki, had a little dramatic part of their lore series, and now the community accepts that this event happened, even though it's not part of the official canon. It has become part of the fanon, or fan canon. And as far as the Elder Scrolls lore community goes, fanon doesn't exist. They reject that principle entirely. What really muddles the waters is several former Bethesda writers continued to write about Elder Scrolls lore. Not all of them, just two or three. Because while they weren't working for Bethesda, they still had a lot of fun writing what they were originally writing when they did work for Bethesda. Many of them used to do it in the old Bethesda forums. Much of what was written back then has been accepted into, air quotes, popular truth as canon, even though it's not. Now, the most infamous of these former Morrowind developers, and one whose writings are still around to this day, is the aforementioned Michael Kirkbride. Now, even less confirmed than the other things I've heard, I've been told that somewhat like the other developers' narrative ideas and the Daggerfall / Arena lore that was thrown away in favor of realism, so too was some of Kirkbride's writings dismissed as Kirkbride's nonsense. Although they'd never say that to his face, that's how they felt, at least how they reportedly felt. This is important because when you have a lead designer calling the shots, and you have a game director approving or denying those shots, you've got a structure where no game contains 100% of a person's personality. It's molded and shaped. The elements that don't benefit the project are cut out. In this way, we can assume that Kirkbride's writings were filtered to some extent. And that's why his writings, such as the Sermons of Vivec, were placed in a purposely ambiguous context. The thing is, the reason I mentioned him at all is because he never stopped. He kept writing after his job on Morrowind was over. And while he was contracted to work on Knights of the Nine for Oblivion, and yes, his many-headed Talos was adapted, and I mean parts of it were cut out. Not the whole speech was used, but Heimskr's speech in Skyrim is actually that many-headed Talos. Of course, giving it to a raving lunatic was, again, Bethesda's way of making that particular piece of lore seem ambiguous, just like they originally did with the Sermons of Vivec. But here's the thing. Between Morrowind and Oblivion, and between Oblivion and Skyrim, he was still writing. There's tons and tons of his out-of-game lore laying around the internet, most of which will never see an entry in an Elder Scrolls game. And if it will, it will most certainly be in an ambiguous context, as all the rest of his lore was made into. Now, before we get into a suing for slander mood, I have to say this isn't confirmed fact. This is hearsay, based on an interview that I managed to recover, which was taken down from the Imperial Library. Now, from a person who was formerly working with the website, the Imperial Library, they say that Kirkbride was rather defensive about his out-of-game writings, and once an interview with several Morrowind developers that contained many of the things that I have already mentioned to you guys was once posted on their website. They reportedly received an email from Kirkbride allegedly demanding that the Imperial Library take down the interview immediately, or he would use every legal course open to him to have all his copyrighted material from after he left Bethesda removed from their website. Now, because the Imperial Library is heavily dependent on out-of-game lore to become an authority on complete Elder Scrolls lore, both in and out of game, they had no choice. They didn't want their website to be rendered worthless, so they did what they had to do. They gave in to him and removed the interview, reportedly giving in to the alleged ultimatum. Notice the way I'm using these non-committal words a shit ton in this spot? Because the reason is none of this can be proven, and I don't want to get sued by someone who has already allegedly threatened legal action. Simply put, you can't kill an idea. If something's on the internet, it's like a hydra. It's going to come back with two heads, sooner or later. Now, if you look at websites, forums, and the Elder Scrolls lore subreddit, you're going to notice something. The community vigorously holds up Kirkbride's out-of-game lore writings as canon. And more recently, the concept of canon not existing at all, and the lore writer, whoever is writing the lore at the time, determines what is and isn't canon. In other words, it's an evolving mentality, originally starting at complete and total acceptance of Michael Kirkbride's work, and then kind of melting into this, well, canon really doesn't matter. Now, I have a confession to make. A lot of my lore series is in fact derivative work of Michael Kirkbride's out-of-game writings, and of course, all of his is derivative work for what he did for Bethesda. Intellectual property owned by Bethesda. Derivative work of derivative work of derivative work. So who actually contains the ownership of it? The thing is that copyright isn't necessarily the same thing as intellectual property. They are similar concepts, and most often they walk hand in hand, but in this case, Bethesda can own the intellectual property rights, and I can own a copyright to what I wrote. Now, luckily, Bethesda continues to enjoy copyright on all their material regardless of who uses it and for what purpose. It's trademark, where they could get into trouble for things, so if you want to release your own version of the Elder Scrolls, you better not call it the Elder Scrolls. To quote Futurama, "We resemble but are legally distinct from the Lollipop Guild." That's pretty much accurate. Bethesda can, but doesn't have to turn a blind eye to infractions on their intellectual property. However, they cannot turn a blind eye to infractions on their trademarks. But let me ask you something. If you have a derivative work of a derivative work of a derivative work, at what point is the lore pure? At what point can you 100% point to an event and say, this is canon, this happened? Well, my answer's simple. Is it in the game? If not, then it isn't. Now, obviously, it's all subject to the unreliable narrator, and we'll get into that a little bit later. But seriously, when you see something extremely boring, and the most uninspired Elder Scrolls lore discussion you could ever have. Something grounded almost 100% in reality, making comparisons to real world events instead of focusing on the things that happened in the past in Tamriel. When you see that happen, chances are those tend to be fans of the newer entries in the series, and they tend to be fans who don't entirely understand the metaphysical side of the Elder Scrolls. Most importantly, it's very unlikely that Michael Kirkbride's writings have anything to do with it. Now, me personally, I'm crafting a narrative, and I use bits of his lore that support that narrative while trying to maintain a coherence of theme. Something that gets entirely broken in Michael Kirkbride's later writings, like Coda, which we'll get into later as well. You see, the lore community's kind of created its own bubble in order to hold their own, well, sometimes I call it awesome and sometimes I call it stupid as fuck, thought experiments. Most often using Kirkbride's lore as a foundation. Because people don't understand Kirkbride's lore, they don't understand what these people in their little lore bubbles are talking about, creating an inherent disconnect between the people who play the game and love it and the people who want to delve into the lore. When people begin to delve into the lore, they find out really quick that there's ambiguity all over the freaking place. Is Talos really a god? Ask Skyrim the game. And other channels that are very Skyrim-centric will ask that question as if it were a matter of religion, as if it were a matter of faith, when, yes, screams Morrowind, because you get to talk to him. Seriously, you actually get to talk to an aspect of Talos. Do you remember at the beginning of Skyrim when he goes, "There were no dragons in Tiber Septim's time, you idiot, they've been gone since forever," that white Redguard? No, screams Daggerfall, Battlespire, and Redguard. In Daggerfall, you hear about a dragon. In Battlespire, you get to see the corpse of a dragon. And in Redguard, you actually get to fight a dragon. And in Redguard, it's Tiber Septim's personal dragon. He even tells you so himself. Are these retcons? Changes the developer made? Nope. These are examples of the unreliable narrator at work. An uncivilized, uneducated group of country bumpkins are most likely going to be wrong about everything from the realms of scholarly learning. They're not history professors. They don't know the truth. That's how the unreliable narrator works. The things the NPCs say, the things written in their books, are often demonstrably incorrect. So people who have played just Skyrim and enjoy it come into direct conflict with people who've enjoyed Skyrim and gone back to look at the older lore. People parroting those country bumpkins, those NPCs in Skyrim who don't know anything, clashing with the meta-knowledge that players have from multiple games. But how much of that meta-knowledge is real? How much of it is canon? Well, the answer is everything that's in the games. But the games themselves are fairly well incomplete and make very little sense when it comes down to what's in the lore books, what's not in the lore books. Especially if you look at like the 1,000-year dragon break that was supposed to have occurred during "Were you there when the dragon broke?" People look at that and go, huh? And want to know more about it. Well, the community wrote a ton more about it. You could say the community put it into context and take that one offhand comment that made zero sense and created its own in-depth piece of lore about it. The problem is that piece of lore never featured in the game. So how do you take this out of game lore? The community will argue that you take it as far as you want to. The community will argue that you create your own Elder Scrolls universe in your head, that the Elder Scrolls is kind of a multiverse containing everyone's vision. And considering we mod our games to have completely different experiences from one another, and via console commands, we can achieve the impossible, and via self-imposed gaming challenges, our experiences are completely different. My Hero of Morrowind made completely different choices from your Hero of Morrowind. And in that context, they are correct. My Elder Scrolls is not your Elder Scrolls. Of course, if that were the case, you could just turn Elder Scrolls into Dark Souls. Dark Souls lore is actually synonymous with the gameplay. You are the chosen undead, but so is your friend playing at the same time. The other player, your friend, is playing within his or her own distorted space-time. These space-times cross and overlap one another, thus you can summon spirits, you can have invaders, these alternate chosen undead, and sometimes the distorted space-time will bend in over itself and return you to where you began, like when you kindle a bonfire. But seriously, what works in Dark Souls, because it is very mechanic-centric, does not work with the Elder Scrolls. The Elder Scrolls is very much your experience, and that's okay. The problem is that people are trying to find meaning in those experiences. So they look at the overall narrative, a broken, incomplete, and ambiguous narrative. However, there's an important thing that both players and the lore community seem to overlook when analyzing an Elder Scrolls game. That is the developers. The lore serves the gameplay only, not the other way around. To the current developers at Bethesda, The Elder Scrolls is not a storytelling medium. It may have been at one point, but now the story is very much there because it enhances the world and it is expected. The heart and soul of an Elder Scrolls game, ever since the first one, has always been the world itself. And you know what? I'm okay with that. Fallout 4 is a broken mess of a game, missing the RPG elements I enjoyed of New Vegas. Thank you, former Black Isle employees working for Obsidian who actually created the Fallout franchise in the first place. But my point is, the heart and soul of the Bethesda open world experience is still there. Having played this most recent game file for 150 hours of playtime, I can confirm that much. Whereas the Morrowind era was very, very much about setting the Elder Scrolls apart from generic fantasy, Oblivion and Skyrim both abandoned the storytelling premise entirely and focused on the gameplay. And if a game isn't fun, then it doesn't matter how great a story it had, you would be better off reading a book. So when people ask, why isn't the story as good as it could be? The answer is that, very clearly, the writers simply don't care about consistency. So the result of all this is there is a huge separation between the lore community, which has its own community-sourced Elder Scrolls universe of ideas, versus what is solidly in the games, what is actually canon. Fan fiction versus canon. The thing is that, as I said earlier, the fan fiction is far better than the canon as far as storytelling, at least most of the time. Because now we're getting into something called coda. You see, for the longest time, the canon wars were going on as to what was canon, what was not. Fan fiction exists in that your interpretation of the Elder Scrolls, and hell, even my interpretation of the Elder Scrolls, is merely a fan fiction that comes closest to explaining away the things that, simply put, aren't explained properly within the lore. Many lore community members would find this to be a damaging opinion, and I have had it called that, a damaging opinion, that your ideas are fan fiction, because they very much kept themselves in this bubble where they want to hold up their own idea of the Elder Scrolls and say, yes, it is this way, absolutely confirmed. I have my own version of the Elder Scrolls that is centered around the Khajiit, and I'm going to talk about my special Khajiit Elder Scrolls. The thing is that 9 times out of 10 when someone does that, they don't actually have a comprehensive fan fiction written. They only have a few forum posts and a bunch of what people refer to as headcanon. Basically what they like to think in their head. Their own version of events. Now, arguments went back and forth. No, you're wrong. That is not how it works. Yes, it is. This is my version of the Elder Scrolls. I've chosen to accept this. Now, working with some other community members, Michael Kirkbride wrote out something known as the C0DA, or CODA. For those of you who don't know, in a performance, a coda, is literally the end of the performance, but it's done in a way that radically changes the tone of the performance. So if you had something that was very somber and very dark, the coda of that performance would be something uplifting and something that completely changes it. After all, it was just a Midsummer Night's Dream. The grand declaration Michael Kirkbride gave when he put out his fan fiction, his coda, about how things were going to happen in the future of the Elder Scrolls, he went ahead and explained that there is no canon, only levels of good ideas. The problem is, in my opinion, there are a shit ton of bad ideas too. I think that ultimately artists critique one another, writers critique one another, and critique is a good thing and should be freely given. That includes the horrible, horrible lip syncing on my videos and my unwillingness to go and edit the audio so it's just synced up right. Because when I look at it, it never looks right. And when other people say it looks right, it doesn't look right to me. My point is, though, when you are an artist, you have your work pinned up in front of the classroom for all the other art students to see. The art students will then be critical about your stuff. And you, as the artist, are expected to learn from that critique. What I see in Michael Kirkbride's coda, I personally feel is unfit to ever be in an Elder Scrolls game. I feel that whilst Michael Kirkbride might be able to write his own science fiction story, I would never want to see the events that transpire in his coda ever happen in any of the games. To which the members of the lore community say, don't worry about it. That's his coda, not yours. In yours, you can have anything happen. But here's the thing. The coda is Michael Kirkbride's fan fiction about what's going to happen in the future of the Elder Scrolls. I almost guarantee you that Bethesda will never use it. But isn't that an interesting shift in tone over the years? To initially go from reportedly nearly pulling all his work off the Imperial Library, allegedly, to declare this community-sourced lore, which the lore community wants to hold up as 100% legitimate and entirely compatible with every single thing Bethesda does. What you consider to be your own version of the Elder Scrolls, your own version of this multiverse, isn't actually canon. It's fan fiction. Speculative fan fiction. Now, I'm sure you can make fan fiction that is better, and far better, than what Bethesda made for the games. I have no doubt about that, because remember, the developers of The Elder Scrolls no longer focus on the story. They focus on the gameplay. The story serves the gameplay. And if there are inconsistencies as a result, well, they don't care. They've proven not to care, at least not enough to prevent it from happening. So that's pretty much the concept of the coda and how the lore community has evolved from something that very much wrote for Daggerfall and actually had its origins in the Elder Scrolls to begin with. This was community-sourced fiction that made its way into the game and became official lore. And now, the community continues to write its own speculative fan fiction, but it refuses to call it fan fiction because there's some kind of stigma on the word fan fiction, as if it's disrespectful or something. And that's ridiculous. Calling your fan fiction a coda and rejecting the label of fan fiction is simply put mislabeling it. And whilst this label may have value to you as an individual, it's very, very confusing to the outside community of people who just play the game. The first thing to accept about Elder Scrolls lore is that it's incomplete, it's broken, and as long as Bethesda doesn't really care about the story, it's only going to get more broken as it goes on. I have an entire series known as The Ideal Elder Scrolls, What If Skyrim Was Good, based on that principle. Don't get me wrong, I love Skyrim, I play it to death, but it is a combination of my critique of the Elder Scrolls and a fan fiction of what the Elder Scrolls could have been. Anyway, the reason for all of this is to basically explain where Bethesda came from, how the lore came to be as it is, and why the lore community is in the state it is right now. Now, the lore community as it is desperate to explain away any kind of developer choices as some kind of piece of the lore. They want to integrate all of it, when in fact, quite a bit of it is just the result of internal company politics on behalf of Bethesda. When I critique parts of the Elder Scrolls, I get members of the lore community in my comment section and sending me direct messages who are desperate to rebuttal my criticisms, which are criticisms with the game design and the writing, with some kind of variant on the dragon break or unreliable narrator or some other metaphysical part of the Elder Scrolls, when in fact the criticism isn't there because I didn't understand it. The criticism is there because I'm pointing past the lore to the developers and writers who decided it was a good idea to do that in the first place. I'm not critiquing the story consistency to where if you explain it to me, I'm suddenly going to be all right with it. I'm asking, Bethesda, why you done this when you could have done that? And I think that the lore community, in its desperate bid to unify everything, many components that just do not fit together, has lost the ability to critique Bethesda. But it's through critique that we realize something's potential. And hopefully, the developers too realize that potential. When developers see wasted potential in something, it means that their next product might be much, much better. And that's our hope. Likewise, the criticisms may not necessarily be aimed only at Bethesda proper, but rather at anyone who wants to make an Elder Scrolls-like game, at any up-and-coming indie developers who view this and, you know, originally wanted to do something very Elder Scrolls-like and thought to themselves, that's a good point, I want to integrate that. And as far as my Elder Scrolls lore criticisms, absolutely. Feel free. So for those of you who want to get into the lore and actually explore it a little bit more, aside from my Elder Scrolls lore series, which is, as I disclaimer the crap out of every single episode, is my personal interpretation of the lore. However, if you want to get started researching it for yourself, I also recommend places like the Imperial Library, which is, again, the house for most of Michael Kirkbride's work. I recommend the TES Lore subreddit, which is a subreddit full of speculative fan fiction. Keep in mind that if you say something is stupid or impossible, or, you know, you use a very fact-based stance, you're very likely to get banned off of it pretty damn quick. The Bethesda lore forums are kind of the light version, because you have this commingling of people who very much know the lore and then other people who have no idea what the hell they're talking about. So it creates a very interesting set of explanation after explanation after explanation. As a result, the Bethesda forums may be the best place to go for your introductions to the lore. I'd also recommend, if you are looking to wiki, going to UESP, the unofficial Elder Scrolls pages, instead of the unofficial Elder Scrolls wiki. Let's just say the unofficial Elder Scrolls wiki sometimes has quality control problems. Not all the time, but often enough to where some of my friends have gotten incorrect information from it. It's not uncommon for a lore series to get a lot of traction on YouTube and then have the Elder Scrolls wiki get vandalized as a result. And when I say vandalized, I mean changed to represent whatever that particular lore episode said, instead of what it actually is. My point is here, number one, there was a lot more to the lore than just Skyrim. The unreliable narrator is a real thing. dragon breaks are a real thing, and the high metaphysics of the Elder Scrolls are a real thing. But also, don't take everyone's word for things, especially this guy right here. You need to be very careful about what he says, because a lot of what he says is his own personal interpretation of the lore, which is, as we covered, speculative fan fiction. If you want the real lore, go back to Elder Scrolls 1, 2, Battlespire, Redguard, 3, 4, and 5. The jury's still out on Elder Scrolls Online. The community thinks it takes place in a dragon break, which is why it hasn't affected the future. But that's just one theory. I'll point you to my What If Elder Scrolls Online Was Good for my theory. Thank you all for watching. Please give the video a thumbs up or a thumbs down, depending on if you liked it or hated it. And please, I'd like to hear from you guys. What is the most bullshit-sounding piece of lore that you've ever heard? I'm very interested, because I've heard tons. People have some weird ideas. Like that guy Zarek in the Puma Theories video who was talking about sword singers. There hasn't been sword singers in a few hundred years. Unless, of course, the Hunding were to manifest one in order to have the Redguards clear way for their people, as is what it did back during the Tiber Wars. Hunding manifestations are incredible, usually wielding Arihalcon weapons. And I will see y'all with live streams and another video next time.